But I'm so grateful to get to do this. This is one of my favorite things to do. Anytime I get to be a part of this ministry, anytime I get to bring the Word of God to this ministry, I'm really blessed by it myself. Always blessed by how receptive you guys are to the Word of the Lord. And so thank you for having me tonight. I'm glad to be here. I've titled my message tonight, Trembling at His Word. And just to go ahead and give you a heads up, if you've got something to take notes with, this is one of those sermons where I'll probably be citing a ton of different scriptures that you won't be able to turn to. So you might want to have something ready to jot these down in case you want to go back and look them up later. But trembling at His Word. I'm sure you guys are aware that we are in the peak of crazy weather season in Middle Tennessee. This is the time of year when it can be hot enough to boil an egg on the sidewalk one minute, and then the next minute you're wondering if your house is going to get destroyed by the trees in your yard. As we've been in this season, one of the things that struck me this year that I realized I just never really thought about before, something that I always took for granted, is just the idea of lightning. And every once in a while I'll have these random rabbit trail thoughts that I'll go on. I'm sure some of y'all can relate to this. But I'll just get, you know, deep into the files of my brain, going down these rabbit trails, just thinking about things that I've never thought before. My wife is pretty scared of lightning. She had an uncle or somebody that got struck by lightning one time during a storm sitting in a chair. Lightning came through the window. Fortunately, he lived and he was fine, but she's the type of person that when it starts storming outside, she won't let the kids get on electronics. She turns the TV off. Nobody can take a shower. Like, it's the whole thing. Like, anything that has anything to do with conducting electricity, you have to stay away from if it's a thunderstorm outside. I'm the opposite. I'm the freak that likes to go out and stand on the porch and watch the whole thing until I can't watch it anymore, until the wind's too strong or I'm getting too wet that I got to go back inside. But this week I was thinking about it, and I was just thinking about how lightning is just one of those things that we just take for granted. I was like, you know, this is bolts of electricity shooting from the sky that could land at any place in any moment, and there's literally no way to know where it's going to hit next. And I just stand out there looking at it, and I'm like, this is crazy. If I looked at this the way that I should look at it, there should be a level of healthy terror. Like, I should be looking at these bolts of electricity that could kill me in a millisecond, and I should have some type of reverence for that. But I don't. I just take it for granted because I've seen it so many times that I'm just like, oh, this is cool. Look at this. I was reminded a few years ago, we lived in Kentucky, and there was a big storm, and it was the first time I'd ever encountered straight-line winds. I don't know if you guys know what those are, but I've been in many tornadoes, and this was more terrifying than a tornado. It was the weirdest thing. I was outside. I think I was mowing the yard or something, and all of a sudden, you know how it is right before a good storm happens, all the birds get quiet at once. There's no sound. If it's really hot outside and it's going to be a really good storm, you feel that. It's not even a breeze. It's just this instant coolness that happens. And so I'm standing out there. I'm like, oh, this is going to be cool. And so I go, you know, I'm mowing the yard, whatever I was doing, and I go and I stand on the front porch and I'm watching this roll in, and then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, with no warning, it's just like this gust of wind. I mean, literally like in a second, and it goes from total stillness to, you know, a 100-year-old tree across the street that didn't even bend. It didn't put up any resistance. It literally just fell. And the root system came up out of the ground, and that root system was twice as tall as me around. And I'm standing on the front porch, like, just watching this. And it was in that moment that I realized that, you know, this was before the lightning thing, but in storms in general, that I realized, man, how small am I? And there's all kinds of these moments in life where something will happen. You know, I think of another example. I don't know if any of you guys are like the beach, but when I get a chance to go to the beach, I love swimming in the ocean. And if any of you have ever been caught in a rip current, it's terrifying. And what's so terrifying about it, and I'm a good swimmer, what's terrifying about it is the same thing that's terrifying about, you know, those straight line winds when I was standing out there, is you go from 1 second feeling like you have total control, like you're in charge of your life, everything's just going like it was the minute before, and everything in the future is going to go just like it's going now. You're in this sense of false security 1 second. And then the next second, you realize how tiny and insignificant you really are compared to the scope of this universe. You know, being pulled out into that rip current, and you realize, I have nothing to compete with the power of this sea. And so as we look at this idea in the book of Isaiah of trembling at His Word, I want us to be I want us to be struck with the idea that this is how we should feel in the presence of God. In the presence of God, we should feel this sense of healthy fear, what I would call a holy terror. And even for the believer, as we'll see, you know, this isn't just a terror for the unbeliever. It's not just a fear of condemnation and judgment. That's a good and right and true fear. But even for the believer, who Brett read for us from the book of Hebrews, that can come boldly before the throne of grace, who can find help and mercy in time of need, for the sinner that can come to God, for the sinner and saint that can come to God and that can receive all that they need, all those things are true. But even that person has to remember that the God that you come before is the great I Am, is the maker of the cosmos, is the one whose power is exponentially greater than that straight line wind. That straight line wind is not a breath of his nostril. That rip current is not a stirring of his finger in the water. That this is the God who we come before. And this is also one of the greatest mysteries of the gospel, is that it's not fluffy, soft, come give me a hug, Jesus, that comes down to save you. It's fire in the eyes, two-edged sword coming out of his mouth, robe dipped in the blood of his enemies. This is how Revelation describes him. It's this Jesus, the King of the universe, that comes down and says, I'll take sinners. I'll take them and I'll change them. And when we have this, when we have a good view of either one of these things, we get out of balance. When we have too much of a view of either one of these things, we get out of balance. When we have too much of a view of the compassion of Christ, which is real and something that you need to set your heart on, the compassion and mercy and grace of Christ, you need that. But when you don't counterbalance that with who this Christ is, then you end up making excuses for your sins. You end up not prioritizing holiness in your life. You end up not fighting temptation because you think, oh, Jesus is just going to forgive me because he's so nice. And in the same regard, when you get too out of balance on the fear of God and the justice of God, and you forget that it's that holy God that offers you forgiveness, when you forget that, then you get into a place of utter despair and discouragement. So what I hope to show us tonight is that there's a balance, but I want to lean in on the fear side because I don't think we talk about that enough. I don't think we talk about the fear of God enough. And so the summary statement that I have for you tonight, this is where we're going to go, and to make it really simple, is this. Just as you can measure your love for God by your obedience to him, so you can measure your closeness to God by your fear of him. And really honing in on the second part of that statement. You can measure your closeness to God by your fear of him. Everyone at least that professes to be a believer, wants to be close to the Lord. You want to have a closer walk with him. You want to know him better. You want to have more of his power in your life so that you can have victory over the sins in your life and so that you can grow and change and mature. Everybody that professes to be a believer has some sense of, I want to be close to the Lord. But not many of us ever pray a prayer that says, God, make me fear you more. Make me tremble at your word. When you speak to my heart, cause a holy terror to rise up in my heart so that I remember who you are and who I am. So that I remember that I am one of billions of billions of creatures that you have made. And that even though you prize me and that you value me because I'm made in your image, the reality is, as it says in the book of Daniel, that I'm accounted as nothing compared to you. We don't often pray prayers that say, Lord, help me remember that. Help me remember that even though you love me, and even though you cherish me and value me, and I have infinite worth because I'm made in your image, help me remember that compared to you, I am insignificant. Compared to you, I am nothing. You know, as John the Baptist said, of Jesus, I'm not worthy to untie the sandals on his feet. Help me remember that kind of fear. And so the first part of it, we're just going to kind of take as a given. We'll talk about this for a minute, but I just want to hope that you know this already from the word, or that you take my word for it. But when we say just, you can measure your love for God by your obedience to him, Jesus just makes this explicitly clear. This doesn't require a whole lot of teaching. In John chapter 14, verse 15, Jesus says, if you love me, you'll do what? Obey my commandments, right? He makes it really clear. If you love me, you obey my commandments. And most of the letter of 1 John is committed to this same idea, that if you say that you walk with him, but you walk in darkness, you don't walk with him. If you say that you belong to him, but you don't walk in his ways, you don't belong to him. In fact, in 1 John 5:3, he says that this is love for God, that we obey his commandments. And this isn't too hard for us to grasp. I mean, if I'm going to say, here's God, and I'm going to profess to love him, then I can measure how much that's really true by how much I obey him. Jesus says again in the Gospels, he says, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and don't do what I say? You know, this is just kind of a common sense thing. If you love him, you will obey him. Now, the opposite is true too. That if you profess to know God and you profess to love him, but you don't obey him, then the Bible doesn't say that you need to try harder or to pat yourself on the back and it's okay because everybody's a sinner and nobody's perfect. The Bible says you're a liar. And that's a hard word. If you profess to know Christ and you walk in disobedience to him, the Bible says you're a liar and that the truth does not dwell in you, that you do not know him and you do not belong to him. Now, that doesn't mean that there's some type of earning our way to knowing Jesus. It doesn't mean that you got to try hard enough and be good enough in order for Jesus to accept you. It's actually the opposite. The point that Scripture's making there is that the only way that you can know God is if he changes your heart and takes up residence inside of you. And if he does that, Ephesians 2:10 says that you will walk in the works that he's prepared beforehand for you. You will change. Titus 3 says the same thing, that you've been saved in order to be changed. And so the whole idea that's being painted there is that if God has saved you by his grace, not by your obedience, saved by grace through faith, nothing you can do. He accepts you solely on the basis of the blood of Jesus. But if that's happened, then the Bible says he puts his spirit in you and gives you a new heart. And if he puts his spirit in you and gives you a new heart, then he causes you to walk in his ways. And so you can measure whether or not you truly belong to him, whether or not you truly love him, whether or not he has given you love for God, by whether or not you obey him. Now, one caveat to that is, well, two, actually, let me say this. Before anybody's inner lawyer rises up and goes back to those cliche phrases of, oh, well, nobody's perfect and everybody's a sinner and sin is sin and God forgives sin and all these things, I want to remind you that Jesus' standard is perfection. Jesus said, be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. In the book of James, it says that if any man keeps the whole law, stumbles in one point, he's guilty of breaking the whole thing. The standard is perfection, which is why you need the blood of Christ to cover your sins. But in order to have the blood of Christ cover your sins, he has to make you new. He has to do something in your heart and change you. And so if that's not you tonight, then the only message for you is to cry out to God to change your heart and to forgive you of your sins and to cleanse you. 1 John, going back to that book, 1:7, he says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. And I just want you to notice, it doesn't say if we try hard that the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sins. It doesn't say if we mentally agree to these propositions that Jesus is the Son of God, Jesus died on the cross, Jesus rose from the dead, okay, I'm going to pray this prayer, that the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sins. He says, no, you can tell whose sins have been cleansed. The ones whose sins have been cleansed are the ones who walk in the light as he is in the light. So again, this comes by grace through faith, not by anything you can do. But if you have received that grace through faith, then walking in the light is what God leads you into. And then the other caveat, just for the believer in the room whose conscience is tender, you know who you are, who is frequently tormented by the enemy. You want to do right. You want to please God. You want to serve him. You know that he has changed you. You know that he has forgiven you, but you keep stumbling. Over and over again. You keep stumbling into sin and then going back to him for forgiveness and then stumbling again and going back again. I'm not talking about you. That desire to obey is in a sense obedience in itself. That desire to please him, that desire to be free from the sin that so easily entangles you, as Hebrews 11 says, is in a sense itself pleasing to him. And so I'm talking about obedience and disobedience in the sense of someone that willfully and intentionally walks in their own ways in opposition to God and has a desire to please themselves as opposed to a desire to please God. That's how you can measure your love for God. If you have a desire to be free from sin for the sake of pleasing him, then you love God. And to the degree that that desire turns into action, you can measure your love for him. And so the second half of the phrase, the one that I said I want us to focus in on, that you can measure your closeness to him by your fear of him, takes a little bit more unpacking because we're not used to talking about the fear of God. Sometimes I think we talk about closeness to God. Sometimes I think we talk about, you know, wanting to get closer to him and know him more. But I don't even know that we talk about that enough. But let's just kind of unpack that a little bit. Psalm 25:14 says this. Psalm 25:14 says, "The friendship of the Lord is for those who fear him, and he makes known to them his covenant." The friendship of the Lord is for those who fear him, and he makes known to them his covenant. Something really interesting about the word friendship in this passage. In the Hebrew, as in the Hebrew Old Testament, as in the Greek New Testament, a lot of times the word choice that we have in the English is an accurate translation, but the original language has a whole lot more meaning and nuance in it than what we can get in our English language. And we do the same thing. You know, we'll say words in a certain context, and in a certain context that word really means like a seven-word sentence if we were really break it down, but we just assume we know what it means because of the context. Well, the same thing's true in these languages. And in Hebrew, in this passage, that word friendship has two other connotations with it. It has a connotation of secret and intimacy. And so what's being described here is not just, I am a friend of God. You know, God isn't mad at me. I don't know if you guys remember this. I'm going to date myself a little bit, but back in the 90s, there used to be these goofy t-shirts and bumper stickers that said stupid things like, "Jesus is my homeboy," right? And so I'm not. That's not what it's talking about with friendship here. What it's talking about is that secret intimacy. It's talking about when, if you ever heard the story of David and Jonathan, where it says that their hearts were knit together. It says that is for the one, not who confesses Christ as Lord. It says that is for the one who fears him. That intimacy is for the one that fears him. If you've ever read the passage where Moses is leading the children of Israel out of Egypt, and the Bible says that Moses spoke to the Lord face to face as a man speaks with a friend. And again, just some more Hebrew word nuggets there for you, where it says face to face, actually better translated mouth to mouth. And I know that sounds weird, but the idea is it's that close. Moses spoke to the Lord mouth to mouth as a man speaks to his friend. And so what Psalm 25:14 is saying is that kind of closeness. The kind of closeness, I don't know if you've ever met a man or a woman like this where you walk away and you just think, man, that person knows the Lord. Where it's almost like you can feel it coming off of them. That's what the Bible says is for those that fear the Lord. And he makes known to them his covenant, his promises. He makes known to them his sure and faithful promises. When this closeness is worked out in action, we see it really in the life of David. Maybe you guys have read Psalm 42 before. Psalm 42, where verses 1 and 2, David's writing and he says, "As the deer pants for flowing streams, so my soul pants for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God?" That's closeness to God. And David feared the Lord. This closeness isn't just warm feelings. Listen, being close to the Lord, being near to the Lord, has nothing to do with I'm not saying it's bad to raise your hands in worship. I'm not saying it's bad to have emotions in worship. Those things are good. Don't hear me wrong. But listen to what I'm saying. That closeness and nearness to the Lord has nothing to do with how high you raise your hands and tight you squint your eyes and loud you sing and the most emotional song that you can sing until you get the chill bumps. That ain't it. Now, the Lord will sometimes use those things, but that ain't it. What David is talking about, the Bible says that David was a man after God's own heart. David prayed things like in Psalm 119. He prayed things like, "Incline my heart to obey your commands." Have you ever fallen on your face before God and not just said, "Oh Lord, forgive me for my sins and keep me from sinning today," but have you ever fallen on your face and begged him, "Make my heart pleasing to you, Lord. Cleanse me of my unrighteousness, Lord. I know my ways. I know how deep the darkness in my heart is. Get rid of it, Lord." Have you treated your sin like a cancer? That's closeness to the Lord. That's what David is describing in Psalm 42 is this idea of, I want to be near him. Brandon mentioned it this morning in his sermon the phrase coram Deo, before the face of God. Closeness to the Lord is seeking to live your life. Again, David says, I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. That's closeness to the Lord. A.W. Tozer has a famous quote that says, no one can know the true grace of God, which is what I'm describing here in this closeness. The idea that the holy God would stoop down and would reach to you and say, you can come near boldly to the throne of grace to seek mercy and help in your time of need. That's the grace of God. And Tozer said, nobody can know the grace of God who has not first known the fear of God. This closeness that we see in Psalm 25:14 is only available to those that fear him. And you can measure your closeness to the Lord not by how many worship things you attend, not by how many worship songs you know. You can measure your closeness to him by your fear of him. And listen, if the idea of fearing God is foreign to you, I don't want to be mean, but you don't know him as well as you think you do, because he inspires fear. And so to say that you know God well without knowing the fear of the Lord is an oxymoron. You can't do it. It's like it's saying that you know a tiger without knowing the ferocity of a tiger. You can't do it. So what does it mean to fear him? Well, the Sunday school answer is to revere him. And that's just usually a way that we try to get around the idea that in some degree fear means fear. We don't want to say, we want to say Christians shouldn't be afraid of God. Right? Because Jesus is soft and fluffy and he's a hippie and he's walking around in Birkenstocks and he just loves everybody and Jesus gets us. That's what we want to say, that Jesus ate with sinners and tax collectors. And so, you know, Christians shouldn't be afraid of God. That's the Old Testament. This fire and brimstone stuff is the Old Testament. And so Christians shouldn't fear God. So we have to find another word to kind of polish it up and say, well, fear just kind of means to revere him. Like you would, like if you walked into a king's courtyard and you kind of bow or curtsy or whatever and show honor to the king. And there's a very, very small splinter of that that's true. But there's a whole nother piece of wood there that says, no, you are to fear him. You are to fear him. Now, for the unbeliever, for the one who does not have Christ as your covering for your sin, you should be terrified. You should be absolutely terrified. If you want to see what you should be terrified of, I encourage you to write this down and go back and read Revelation 14, verses 9 through 11, or Jude 14 and 15. And you can see that the fate that awaits the unbeliever, Hebrews says it is a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. The fate that awaits the unbeliever is the things of nightmares. The Bible says that there will be people prior to the judgment of God that will ask for rocks to fall on them so that they can escape the fury of Jesus. That's in the New Testament, of Jesus. The description that I gave you earlier, fire in the eyes, two-edged sword coming out of his mouth, robe dipped in the blood of his enemies. That's Jesus in the New Testament. That's the one that we're to believe, says love is love and would never ask me to do anything that doesn't make me feel comfortable. That's Jesus, guys. And so what it means to fear him is to revere him, yes, and to honor him and respect him as king. But it also means to fear him. It also means to fear him in the way that I described those storms. It also means when you come into the presence of God, the book of Ecclesiastes says, let your words be few. And what's being said there is not talking about that you don't use a lot of words in prayer or something like that. But what's being said there is don't be making vows and promises and bargains to the God of the universe like he's your buddy. Remember who you're dealing with. Remember that this is the Holy One. His wrath and his anger rest upon the unbeliever. John 3:36, Ephesians 5:6, Romans 2:5. The wrath of God rests upon the unbeliever. But what about believers? Believers are freed from the fear of judgment, right? Romans 8:1 says that there's now therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. John chapter 5 says that believers will not come into judgment because they've already passed from death to life. 1 John 4:18 says there's no fear in love because perfect love casts out all fear, and that the one who fears, because fear has to do with punishment, and the one who fears has not been perfected in love. And so for the believer doesn't have to be afraid in that way, right? Well, yes and no. Yes, you are free from the fear of condemnation. Christ's sacrifice is sufficient to pay for all of your sins. You do not, listen, if you have trusted in Christ, you do not have to fear that God will judge you for your sins because your sins were already judged in Christ. That's absolutely true. But that doesn't change who God is. That doesn't change the fact that he is the same God that, speaking to Moses, said, when we go up here and talk, I want you to set a boundary, and I want you to tell the people of Israel that they don't even come near this mountain, because if they come near the mountain, they're going to die. Matter of fact, don't even let animals come near this mountain, because if these animals come near this mountain, they're going to die. Same God. He might have forgiven you, yes, and you might not be judged and condemned for your sins. Doesn't change who he is. This is the holy, righteous, pure. The Bible says that he's too pure for your eyes to look upon. He told Moses, you can't see my glory and live. This is the same God. And so you might be safe from the wrath of God in Christ, yes, but it doesn't change who he is. Believers in the New Testament are still commanded to fear God. Colossians 3:22-25, I'll just read a portion of it. This is New Testament. Paul says, bondservants, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters, not by way of eye service as people pleasers, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord. Do what you're supposed to do in your normal work life, and do it with the fear of the Lord, knowing that he judges impartially. Philippians 2:12-16, again, just read a portion of it, but Paul, writing to the Philippian church, says, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do his good pleasure, with fear and trembling. 1 Peter 1:17 and following, Peter says, and if you call him as Father, in other words, if you are a believer, if you are saved in Christ from the wrath of God, this is not written to unbelievers, if you call him as Father, he who judges impartially according to each one's deeds, conduct yourselves with fear throughout the time of your exile, knowing that you are ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. So we're free from the wrath and condemnation of God as believers, and yet we're still commanded to fear it. Why is that? Why would we still be commanded to fear if we're free from the wrath and judgment of God? And the answer is because he is God. Because he is God. Isaiah 66:2 is kind of the verse that launched all this. Isaiah 66:2, as I was studying, says, all these things my hand has made. The Lord's talking about the temple. And so these things came to be, declares the Lord. But this is the one to whom I will look, he who is humble and contrite in spirit and trembles at my word. The Lord says, the one whom I am pleased with is the one who trembles when I speak. So my encouragement to you tonight, as you seek to know the Lord, as you seek to grow in your closeness to him, my encouragement to you tonight is to seek to grow in your fear of the Lord. Peter, when Jesus called him, was out fishing, and he's out fishing all night, and he didn't catch anything, and Jesus comes out, and he says, hey, Peter, cast your net over on that side of the boat, and you'll catch some fish. And so Peter, being very casual with the Lord, treating him just like any other man, says, oh, Lord, we've been out fishing all night, we haven't caught anything, but since you said so, okay. And what you notice, this is how Peter was before the thing. And so then he throws the net out, and they catch so many fish that the boat begins to sink, and other guys have to come and help and do it and bring the fish in. And I was telling this passage to a group of kids at camp the other day. I said, how do you think Peter reacted when they saw that Peter brought in all those fish? How do you think Peter reacted to Jesus? And many of them, if you've never heard the story, probably said the same thing that you're probably thinking. Oh, he's probably rejoiced. He's probably grateful. He's probably amazed that Jesus brought in all these fish for them. I said, no. Peter fell down on his face. And this man that he had just said, oh, Lord, we've been fishing all night, but since you say so, I'll do it. Now he looked at Jesus completely different. And he fell down on his face, and this is what he said. Peter said, go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man. Peter's response was the same response of Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 6, when Isaiah sees the glory of the Lord, and he says, woe is me, for I am undone, for I am a man of unclean lips from a people of unclean people, and I have seen the Lord Most High. The idea is that when Peter saw Jesus as the Christ, when Isaiah saw the Lord in his glory, both responses were the same. They were fear and trembling. And in both cases, the Lord in his grace relieves that fear, and he says, don't be afraid. I've atoned for your sins. But the fear had to come first. And the Lord delights when we remember that he is God and you are not. And the fear of God is one of the greatest weapons that you have in fighting sin. Because when you remember that you are not the center of the universe, it's a whole lot easier to remember that pleasing yourself is not nearly as important as pleasing the one who is the center of the universe. For those of you that are followers of Christ tonight, seek to fear the Lord more. The practical way to do that, two things, really simple. Number one, ask him for it. He says he's pleased with it. He's pleased. He looks to those who tremble at his word. Ask him for it. Will he not give you the very thing that he desires for you if you seek it? He will. And then the second encouragement is super practical. You know all those passages that you skip over when you're reading the Bible all the time? The scary ones about judgment and wrath and people being dashed to pieces and fire and brimstone falling from the sky? Stop skipping over them. Read them and suck it up. And realize that this is the God that you serve and that you should fear him. Not fear for condemnation of your sins, but fear because he is God. And if you are not a believer in Christ tonight, again, the only application for you, to flee the wrath to come. Run to the arms of Jesus tonight, who suffered that wrath on your behalf, and he will protect you because he died for the sins of all who call upon him, and he rose again to receive them. As I've said many times before, my favorite things about the gospel is that if you want Jesus, you can have him. If you want to be saved from the wrath of God through Christ, you can have him. Let me pray for us. Father, thank you for revealing your greatness to us in Scripture. Thank you for revealing your glory and your majesty. And I pray that you would give us strong hearts to see and embrace how great and mighty and terrifying, Lord, you are. And I pray that you would ease our hearts just as you did with Peter, just as you did with John in the Revelation, just as you did with Isaiah, that when we respond to you in that appropriate holy terror, that you would say to us, do not be afraid. Your guilt is atoned for. Help us do that in Jesus' name. Amen.